our culture. It's not reflected in the school books.
Shakespeare just doesn't interest me. I'd rather do something for myself.
I rose like a star.
Yeah. I don't date a race, I date a person.
It doesn't matter if he's black, or if he's white, or if he's Chinese, or if he's purple. If we could reach into a lot of people's minds, like, you would be surprised what they think of black people.
Once a year, we'll have International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, and then that's it.
Sometimes we're ignorant ourselves of our own heritage.
How many black people do you see running the country, you know?
I wish that today in history class that we could learn more about black culture.
I never seen no movie on all great kingdoms in Africa and nothing like that.
You can't complain about it and not do anything about it.
There's been a black community in Nova Scotia for over 300 years, but you wouldn't know it by the history books. You won't find our faces on the postcards. You won't find our statues in the parks. The only time white people seem to notice us is when they want to call us nigger or say we've got an attitude. Well, my name's Shingai. I'm 16, and my attitude is, you don't have to be from Scotland to have a history. My mom comes from an old Dartmouth family. My father comes from Zimbabwe, Africa. He took us there for a visit when I was 12. What an experience. A whole country run by black people. From the prime minister, to the police, and the media. It seemed completely normal, and it made me really proud. Back home, it's a different story.
At the top of the news this hour, officials are trying to sort out what happened in Halifax last night as a crowd of blacks rampaged through Halifax's downtown bar district. Black leaders say, although the violence was sparked by some bars denying entry to blacks, the real cause is underlying racism in this city. The Cultural Awareness Youth Group is at this hour organizing a peace and justice march. Youth leaders say the event is timed to coincide with other marches taking place in Montreal and Toronto.
The role of youth in social change and social justice is not new to black people. Youth were very actively involved in the civil rights movement of the 60s. And it was that involvement that helped change discriminatory laws and practices in North America. Youth in this province are frustrated that the opportunities to succeed in the metro community and this province appear to be denied to us because we are black. We are frustrated that our views, hopes, and concerns are not taken seriously.
For my sister Tandy, the rally was a real turning point. She'd been wanting to do something around school for about a year. After she worked with the Culture Awareness to organize a rally, she decided to start a chapter as soon as school began in the fall.
So you guys can just put these up like down by the cafeteria and by the front. The main hall.
Okay. Thanks a lot,
team. St. Pat's is a good school with a lot to offer. Courses in law, economics, science. You can even take them in French if you want. It's a lot harder to find something about us, and that's what we wanted. So we looked beyond the school to find people who could understand what it's like to be black.
My name is David Woods.
I'm a writer, an actor, director, and I'm here today to maybe explore with your group the possibilities of creating a drama that reflects your lives and maybe says something that you feel is important to be said. Drama to me is one of the most important tools we have in terms of expression. Drama allows us to say things that sometimes we are aware of, but the rest of the world is not aware of. And we have a vast number of our own lives to draw from. I want you all to think about your growing up here in Nova Scotia, in Halifax. What kind of things has affected some of you as a black person? It can either be good, bad, whatever, but something that really just made you think. When was the first time, as a young child, you thought about this idea of blackness? Shinga.
Like, yeah, I remember when I was little and I'd be watching TV. You never see any black people on TV. Now, it's better now, right. You know, about 10 years later or whatever. Yeah. But,
got the Cosby Show,
you know,
now.
Got the Cosby Show in effect, you know, but just like commercials and stuff, you know, it'd always be blonde hair, blue eyes. I just wonder why, you know, why there aren't any black people on TV, you know?
Yeah.
What's, you know, what's wrong with black people? Yeah. Are we ugly or whatever?
Anybody else?
I walked into a class and all they saw was white people.
How did that make you feel?
Not too good, actually. Well, after a while, I just accepted it, right? But at first, like, I didn't want to go to school. I just wanted to stay at home.
One more. True confessions, yeah. Speak to me.
When I was in elementary, a lot of times when we'd be reading different books and things like that, I always kind of, sometimes I'd sit there and worry, almost. It was strange, but I'd worry that they'd say something in the book about black people. Right. And I never really, it was
and
strange.
And why were you
but
worried?
Because I'd always think that they'd say something bad.
Yeah.
I remember one time I was reading a book called The Secret Garden, and there was a part in it, and they said something about you can't trust the dirty blacks. And all of a sudden, all the heads would turn and look at me.
Go ahead with the Africans. I want a strong establishing. Let's start. So you count to five.
I was born in Africa, a black woman. In a place called the Rural Plains. Aurora means land of the free. I am free. I have lived there for centuries. I was Yoruba, Fulani, Osa, Igbo, Ashanti. I spoke in many tongues. I pounded the drum in sacred sound. Stared into the horizon and was content.
When Europeans came, green fire and lightning their eyes, enslaved 15 million men and women, destroyed villages, ruined families, murdered children, all under the guise of a just God. I am the first stage of the black race. I have felt my soul raped.
It's hard, you know, to think, oh my goodness, like racism is still there. I remember I walked in the last stall in the bathroom and said, you know, niggers should be locked up in chains. It makes you wonder, like, who's writing it? Is it, are people just writing to be funny? You know, well, they're not funny.
You know, I find, like, a lot of the teachers at school, they're like, they think it's like there's no racism at school, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They think it's a racism-free environment. And I just don't see how they can be so naive, you know, when it's spitting right in their face.
It's not like everybody in the school is KKK, but almost everybody's white. White teachers, white history, white culture. It's like if you're white, you belong. But if you're black, you're just sort of here.
Because they were scared, especially scared of communism. And so they were ready to turn to the only alternative that seemed capable of providing the land they wanted and did not receive at the end of the war.
The existing system was very weak.
I'm not saying that we don't want to learn these things. We do.
We said the power rested where?
It's just that we need to know things the school doesn't teach. And at our meetings, Sean, Amy, Lawrence, we all decide what that should be. It's great to have a place where we come first, where we decide what's important.
We're going to be talking about the conference, our quiz that's coming up, Black History Week, and David Woods' play.
I was thinking that it might be a good idea if we could tie in our play with our Black History Week. And
I'll just perform it here at the school?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think that would be an excellent idea, actually.
Great. Okay, so our Black History
Candy
Week
and Krista,
is what we want to know.
They were always looking for people who could understand us.
You got to go to school. I don't want to stay home and be no real fool. Go ahead. I lost it. Let's pick it up. One more group.
Here we go.
Y'all right here with my St. Pat's crew. I'm gonna rock the mic, gonna rock it for you. I'm on the microphone all by myself, and I'ma kick it to everybody out there looking like an elf. Cause I'm big and I'm strong and I'm the man. I can rap like no. I had to go. I'm going.
Robert Upshaw has taught school, but not at St. Pat's. When we asked him to talk to us,
Right away,
he knew what we were looking for.
One of the things that obviously comes to the situation is we must ask questions, are there materials available? And if so, why haven't they been placed into the curriculum already? Are the people who are responsible for teaching the materials capable of teaching the materials?
I think the system's more than capable of changing. If they really wanted to push Black history through, I think they could.
Well, I think that since there's so few Blacks in schools, like compared to white students, that I don't think they really want to make the effort just to please 30 or 40 kids in one school.
It just doesn't seem right for a school, like a school system, to think that way. You know, like not to include a race of people if they're really, like, they're supposed to be an institution of learning.
In asking for Black history and in looking for equal representation, it is not about race, it is about equal expectation. And that's the most important thing. One of the things about expectations I always point about is during my wedding, where two complete strangers sat on top of my wedding cake. Didn't look like me or my wife at all. But the expectation for me to sit on top of my wedding cake, my own wedding cake, wasn't there. And could you imagine if I had sat on top of someone else's wedding cake?
Yeah.
Grandmama asking, what are those colored people doing on top of the wedding cake? And you see, it is as simple as the top of a wedding cake to a book to Black history. This is a reflection of the larger society institutionalizing racism. And if it exists in the larger society, then it's no wonder that racism exists in the education system.
Institutional racism. Tell me about it. I remember my grade 7 history text said 380 odd pages, 1.5 about us. We've done more than a page and a half. You look through the index of just about any history book, it's like we've been erased. I know there are separate books about us, but if you're not reflected in the main text, draw your own conclusions. I knew if I put my mind to it, I could find ways of learning and passing on my history.
First thing I want to say is, don't be nervous. You're being marked on having prepared and trying, right? And I know different people have different states of nerves, so don't worry about it. I think I've got everyone's cards now. And the first person to speak is going to be Shingai, Canada at 125, and specifically 125 years of Black history in Nova Scotia. It's all yours, Shingai.
Hi. Today I want to speak to you about the history of Blacks in Nova Scotia. It's a history that I'm sure not many of you would be familiar with. I'll never forget how my mother would tell me stories about having to learn about Little Black Sambo and having all the other white students point and laugh at her while the teacher forced her to read it. We have to remember that the problems we have today are a direct result of the system which we inherited. So it should never be forgotten that Nova Scotia was a slave society. Their direct references...
Of course I was nervous. I felt like I had 5 minutes to tell them everything that isn't in those history books. And I'm just learning about it myself. I wanted to tell them how the headings in my Canadian history book would read. I wanted to put all the black faces back under Nova Scotia's story.
The world's most disgraceful institutions. From chains and whips, I rose a freed man. My cultured mire, my children scattered like the wind, my mind scarred for centuries to come, and yet I had to endure more pain. Back of the bus, segregated schooling, lynching in the South, slave labor, degradation in the media. I wondered when I could find my rest. The agony in my heart poured out so, yet my belief in God made me. I invented traffic lights, agricultural products, the process to preserve blood. I wrote the Three Musketeers, God's trombones, roots, the color purple. I danced in a cotton club and screamed that I inspired your greatest man of this century to lead our civil rights movement and pronounce our dream. I have a dream, he said, as the whole world listened. I loved like no one before. I felt like no one before. I went to the mountaintop discovering how to love myself.
One of our big events was a weekend conference put on by Culture Awareness during Black History Month. Young people from all over Nova Scotia came together. Take on the problems we all share.
Okay. All right, good stuff. This is your... No, Shenga, you have to back here at 7:30 for the reception. Yes.
Okay.
All right, so just go. Thank you so much.
The first workshop was about identity. Who are we anyway? It seemed to me like a good place to start.
We can't really go back and identify exactly which country we were brought over as slaves from. So the best we can do is take the continent. And why not settle for it? And another thing is that, you know, eventually, as things change from nigger to colored to Negro to black, you know, it's gonna change again to probably African Canadian, African American, African whatever. So you know, it's just gonna change, and you know, you gotta flow with it.
My mother dyed colored, but she was a proud black woman in my eyes. You see, but she dyed colored black. What? Don't call me black boy. Are you stupid? You know? So my mother, because that is what she come to be labeled as and grew with.
For one of the workshops, we went to a theater for a special showing of Spike Lee's movie, Jungle Fever. It's about an interracial relationship between a black man and his white secretary. A hot topic for a lot of us.
Something to say, just stand up and I'll point you out and you can just express your opinion. But we want you to be courteous to each other and respect each other's opinion. No need for argument, just a nice little discussion, friendly and all.
Behind Spike Lee's making of this film is because he wants people to look at the things that are not in your control when you decide to enter into a relationship of this nature.
If you met a white man that you really liked and he felt the exact same way about you
and your friends were kind of queasy about it, and your family wasn't happy with it, you wouldn't be with that person?
Are you prepared to deal with all of the problems, and I say problems, because they are problems that come with interracial relationships. And I have to question myself and say, do I want to deal with all of that? And the answer is no.
Just replace interracial marriage with the right to vote, okay? Now you're gonna tell me that if I weigh all the, back in the day, when blacks were denied the vote, I mean, you got lynched if you tried to vote. The Klan tried to get you, you know, they tried to, don't vote, or we'll get you. Now, with all those odds, we got the vote today. Now you're gonna tell me that it's wrong just because society right now is being racist towards two people that care about each other, and I put emphasis on people, that it's wrong, that they shouldn't try to change it because society is wrong and not them? No, I think you missed the point.
We got that vote by black people pulling together and marching and so on.
Black people. It just wasn't black people. They're white people too.
I am a black woman and I prefer to have a black man and black children.
I see a lot of mixed children here. I see a lot of mixed people here.
Workshop this morning is called Coping with Racism, and that's going to be in the Alderney room.
Yeah, that's true. Come on, get off the boat. It's sailing away. Get off the boat.
Good morning, everyone. The leaders in this workshop are Sherry Bernard and Brian Johnson.
You're all a bunch of lazy individuals. Every one of you. Now, did that hurt anybody?
No.
Did anybody feel like they wanted to jump up and punch me in the mouth?
I was too lazy.
Would it have been different if I'd have said to you, you're all a bunch of niggers?
You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, not really.
The focus of our workshop is coping with racism, how to fight back. Now, if when I said those things to you, y'all had jumped up here and started beating on me, that would have been one way of fighting back. But some of us would have gotten hurt. Some of us might have even have been arrested.
What are you gonna do? You know, you're gonna file a complaint?
You can write letters, stage protests. You can challenge the system so that you can start to affect some change in society.
I've been called every name there is to be called because of my profession. When I've arrested people. But that does not give me the right to punch somebody in the mouth. It hurts me when somebody says, you're nothing but a black nigger. Still, it hurts me. But still doesn't give me the right to punch the person in the mouth. It doesn't. I know, the hair on the back of your neck will curl and everything else, and your stomach will be tied up in knots, and you'll lose your ability to speak, but you can just keep right on walking.
It's very hard for us just to walk by and just let it go.
I know, but you gotta do it. I know what you're saying.
I didn't come all this way for nothing, you know? I didn't come this way to be called a nigger and walk by if I can't do anything about
it. But you're going backwards. But you're not advancing forward because you're no good to the rest of society if you're in jail. You've got to think of the consequences before you do anything.
The conference was great. We talked a lot, learned a lot. I guess it hasn't stopped anyone from yelling nigger or writing things on the walls, but now we're a lot stronger. One of the best things about learning is passing on what you've discovered to other people. And that's where a drama came in. It seemed to make the whole year worthwhile.
All right, so go ahead and start again. Smile, baby. Krista, smile. Smile. When you're feeling lonely.
This is a conference.
All right, so we'll do the same thing. Trying to integrate the music. So kind of keep in mind the things I told you about. Now you speak.
arrived in Nova Scotia in 1603 and navigated for the French fleet. I came as a slave in the 1600s. I came as a loyalist escaping slavery. I was settled in barren places, places that nobody else wanted. On rocky, barren soil, Sunnyville, Lincolnville, Preston, Halifax, Birchtown. I was used as cheap labor. I was starved and left to suffer. I was made to feel the harsh brunt of experience in order to survive. As time changed, I expected more than labor to be my lot. I expected more than a simple life in a hidden spot. I reached out for education on the shores of Nova Scotia. I was Richard Preston, founding churches all around the province. I was William White, speaking out against discrimination. I was a soldier in No. 2 Construction Battalion, fighting in World War I. I was Portia White, singing out to the entire world. Yet my voice still has a cry. Yet my heart still feels the pain as I walk through the streets of Halifax, Amherst, Sydney. But I still have my dream. I have my dream, Nova Scotia. I am somebody. I am somebody.
If you can speak your mind, that's the best thing that could ever happen. I'm glad that God gave me the gift.
Thank you. I hear that.
What's up, we share you fun?
That's a really good session talking about.